GearNetwork.com.
The following is a presentation of the Gear Radio Network. The following is a presentation of the Gear Radio Network.
I believe it's a big challenge for our building to keep things in perspective and to, if we're going to get addicted to anything, let's get addicted to the process.
And with that, we welcome you back to Trust the Podcast, powered by Better Live Than Dead and the Gear Radio Network. This is episode 63, the COVID-19 preseason preview.
Episode 6, mother 3, people. How the hell? Oh my God, I'm freaking excited, man.
For the first time in 8 months, Trust the Podcast is back on the air. The last time we talked to you, it was moments after the Buffalo Bills lost to the Houston Texans in an exciting yet heartbreaking 22-19 playoff matchup in overtime. But before we get there, I am Ryan Wolfe at Wolfe BLTD. You can hear this podcast and all Gear Network and Better Live Than Dead podcasts on betterlivethandead.com, gearnetwork.com, Apple Podcasts, Bullhorn, Google Play Music, which I'm pretty sure is going to be YouTube Music soon, iHeartRadio, Pandora, the radio.com app, Spotify, YouTube, and wherever you listen to podcasts. And just like last season, joining me on the IndyCar Media Hotline, the man himself, John Cimino, at IamJCMona on Twitter. John, it's good to have you back.
It is good to hear your voice, my man. It is good to be back. And yes, as the Bills Mafia's favorite Jets fan, and you know, I mean, you guys are going to have a bye week in week one, let's face it. But regardless, I am very, very happy to be here. I'm very happy to talk about the hometown team. And also, I want to point out to Amazon, believe it or not, we're not an affiliate with them. Not anymore. But they have a podcast, like, or they're getting into the podcast game or something. So I don't really know a whole lot about it. I just know I signed up all the Gear Network podcasts for it. So we're going to be on whatever the hell Amazon runs, for podcasting. So if you believe in the Amazon Bezos system there, we'll be on there soon enough. So,
and you might hear my dog in the background barking. He's very spirited upstairs.
You hear your dog. You probably hear my daughter back there. I tell her to be quiet, and she doesn't listen. So.
Well, I was going to say, I'm currently in my kitchen now in my new house. I was going to have an office set up, but I was having some trouble with some allergy issues, and I come to find out I pull up the carpet in the basement, and it's full of old pee. So,
that was exciting. That's the worst. Like,
but it makes sense, though.
When you buy a house from an old cat person, like, it's literally, like, every single time. I guess I shouldn't say, because I've been at my house for now almost 10 years, and I've had dogs and cats here. But, like, they don't, like, pee on the rug or anything. And if they did, I'd clean it up. I'm quick to clean it up or whatever. But I guess I fear when I'm ready to pull the carpets off in the main room, like, if I peel up the carpets and I hear, like, a cat screech, like, you know. But that's, like, the thing, man. Like, I remember when I was a teenager and my mom bought this house in Greece, and it was, like, this, you know, cheaper little house, which I still have a, you know, I, every time I pass by, I'm like, oh, I'd love to buy that house. But then I think about it and I'm like, no, I don't want to. But, like, that was the thing. We walked into the house. There was old carpets there and it reeked of cat piss, like, everywhere. And so I feel your pain there, Ryan.
So I've got this really nice desk downstairs with my really fancy microphone, and instead I'm here tonight in my half-painted first floor at my table that I bought from someone off of Facebook for $75. It's a nice table, don't get me wrong, but you would not be able to hear my dog losing his freaking mind in the background. But, like,
well,
I said,
you know,
John,
what? Before we get going here, because my on-again, off-again, TJCMS, the JC Money Show partner, Emma, my daughter, who always likes to appear on camera when I do the video casts, always likes to have her hand. She's going to run Gear Network by the time I'm done with it in like 3 years. But hang on. Emma, come here. She's going to be on Trust the Podcast now. This is a season premiere. I'm getting everybody here. Hold on. Emma, come here.
Pulling out all the stops today. I love it.
What do you want now? You want your phone. You have your phone in your hand. You want more time on your phone. That's what you want?
Yes.
I'm going to give you 10 more minutes on it, okay?
Okay.
But this is what you need to do. First, look, come to the microphone. It's not a video cast. I want you to repeat after me. Say, hi, trust the podcast listeners.
Hi, trust the podcast listeners.
And then tell them S-A-D.
S-A-D.
No, I'm kidding. Yeah, I didn't really think you actually knew that. Get out of here. I'm gonna go give you 10 more minutes. Holy shit. I hope your mom doesn't hear this. I don't really care. Who cares? She's useless.
Well, anyways, go ahead. Hey, since the last time we chatted, man, it's been a while. I haven't been on a podcast.
Sorry, Ryan. You know I bring the shtick on here. Sorry.
Look, I'm okay with it. It's nice to pull out all the stops and have some fun because, like I said, I haven't been on a podcast. I'm better alive than dead since the end of June. It's been a wild year, been a crazy year, been a busy year, trying to take it back, you know?
That's right. It's weird.
It's weird because that kind of rolls into the football season with no preseason, training camps being locked down, not getting really any news reports out. It almost feels strange to say that the National Football League season starts this week. I mean – The official fantasy football league, the Wolfe Center Football League, the official fantasy football league of Better Live Than Dead, we are taking a hiatus this year just because there's so much uncertainty. I would hate to have everybody pay and start playing and then get eight games into the season and have football get canceled. Now,
you know what? That's why with my fantasy leagues, I didn't do pay because I don't know. We don't know. You know
absolutely.
What I mean? I didn't do pay, and I said anybody that wants to play, you know, good play. And then most people played. Your brother quit on me though on my other league though. That bastard.
What a punk! I was gonna say for me, it came down to the uncertainty of COVID, and then with moving and all this stuff, packing, unpacking. I had literally one day that I would have to like make sure everyone could do the draft, and I'd have to absolutely nail it, and I would have still been super busy that day. So I figured it was a good idea to punt on the season, but. The NFL, they're not punting on their season, John. And that brings us to our three big things. We're going to talk about the what has happened essentially since the Bills walked off the field from the time they lost that game in Houston to September 8th, 2020, right now, 8:25 p.m., breaking down the fourth wall as we talk about the Buffalo Bills on Trust the Podcast. First off, new faces in Buffalo. A lot of big things happening since, like I said, since the last time the Buffalo Bills took the field in a regular season football game, or that at that case, a postseason football game. There are a handful of new players that the Buffalo Bills drafted, expected to make an immediate impact. You've got defensive end AJ Epinesa from Iowa, a second round pick, 54th overall. Running back Zach Moss from Utah, a third round pick, 86th overall. And this may feel strange to listen to and hear, but kicker Tyler Bass expected to make a big impact because he won the job over incumbent Steven Hauschka, who has since been released. Tyler Bass from Georgia Southern, a sixth round pick, 188th overall. It looked like it was a pretty good draft for the Buffalo Bills. I mean, they didn't need a whole lot to, they just kind of needed to get a little deeper and retool, which it seems like they did that. Now there's a little fire under Devin Singletary who, If he continues to have fumbling issues like he showed last season, there's another guy right behind him who could pick up the slack. And Zach Moss, there was some hype going into the draft about his prospects headed to the National Football League. But for me, John, the guy that I'm most excited about naturally is AJ Epinesa out of Iowa, the kid coming off the end. I think that it's going to make the defense that much better. And it never hurts to draft and develop your own really good pass rushing.
Oh, absolutely. It doesn't hurt to do that. I'm surprised though. I almost called you Brandon because Brandon and I still do the podcast every now and then, although we haven't podcasted in a couple of weeks. I'm surprised you didn't mention the recent signing of Brian Cox Jr., September the 6th. I'm surprised you did not mention that
you're
one.
You're talking about, we don't talk about practice here.
Well, listen, Allen Iverson, come on now. You know, it's not bad to talk about the thing there, but no, building a defensive core is obviously a solid thing, especially if you have an offense that can be, and it looks, I mean, on paper, everything on paper, you know, before the season actually begins is great. Ask the Cleveland Browns, but this offense, the job.
Are you talking about Odell Beckham Jr. getting pooped on?
I mean, well, whatever, but maybe, but what I'm saying is that like on paper before the season begins, everything looks great for literally every team except for the New York Jets. But
fair,
like the Bills offense they did a good job with their offense. You know, they took a offense that did rather that did okay last year, you know, and it's sometimes very, very good, like rather well. And they made it better with the addition of Stephon Diggs. So when you think about it, if an offense is high powered and they have no issue scoring the ball, let's just say the Bills have no issue scoring this season with on offense, Singletary or Diggs or Brown or whomever, or Allen with his legs, for Christ's sakes, you know, if the offense is going to score, and if they score quickly, or if they're constantly bringing up the score, and the defense is always on the field, it's good to have good, solid people that have their wind beneath them and can do the job to, you know, supplementing all of the scoring for the offense. So building a solid defense is a great thing. And AJ Epineza, I should know how to say that name, but I don't, apparently, is a solid addition. 54th overall is not a bad place to be picked, and typically second and third round draft picks are usually the money maker picks. Maybe not so much the sexiest picks during the draft, but when you get to that second, you get to that third round pick, you know, you're getting those. They're going to have an extra chip on their shoulder because they feel that they should be at least a round above what they were picked. So they're coming in with their chip on their shoulder. And also Epineza, he's one of the Samoans. And as a professional wrestler that is very well versed in the Samoan culture and the Samoan, the way that the Samoan wrestlers, you know, and their ethnicity and everything that has been, you know, shown on screen, like, this guy's going to be a horse. He's going to work. He's going to work hard. And I think that that's a great pick. And if he develops as fast as I believe he will develop, the Bills are going to be in pretty good shape on the defense.
Now, you talked about first round picks being sexy, and you mentioned Stephon Diggs. That's the next thing I do want to talk about here. The Buffalo Bills did not have a first round pick this year, so AJ Epineza was their top pick in the draft. We go back to March 16th, 2020. The Buffalo Bills essentially go all in on Josh Allen. We'll talk about that in just a second, but they acquire wide receiver Stephon Diggs and a 2020 seventh round pick from the Minnesota Vikings in exchange for a 2020 first round pick, a 2020 fifth round pick, a 2020 sixth round pick, and a 2021 fourth round pick. Last season with the Minnesota Vikings, Stephon Diggs in 15 games had 94 targets, 63 receptions, 1,130 yards, and 6 touchdowns. And most importantly, he is a bona fide number one wide receiver that the Buffalo Bills really have been missing.
Absolutely. That is the missing piece that they needed. And that is what, and that's the thing is, for as much as I like to get on the Dallas Cowboys and talk about Jerry Jones and how much of a clown shoe he is, when he threw in the number one pick to get Amari Cooper, that was him saying, okay, this guy, this receiver is worth my number one pick this year because there's no receiver I feel that's as good or comparable as this guy is. And that's what the Buffalo Bills did this offseason with Stephon Diggs. They gave their number one pick to the Minnesota Vikings for Diggs because they felt that of all the receivers, and this was a very receiver heavy draft, but they felt of all of the receivers, spending their first round pick trading for a semi-disgruntled receiver in Minnesota that was already established by a few years anyways in the National Football League, was well worth the risk of losing out on one of these, maybe, you know, and I'm saying maybe because I, you know, the verdict's out on CeeDee Lamb and Denzel Mims and all those guys, but Diggs has been proven. Yep. And he's been proven with quarterbacks that are lesser talented than Josh Allen is.
I mean, you got him. He played last season with a quarterback who said, quote, if I die, I die. And then said, you know, it was out of context.
But Kirk Cousins is a brain. He's a football player. No one ever accused Kirk Cousins of being a brain surgeon.
He might be a dum-dum off the football field, but he's a very smart man getting all that guaranteed money.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Next to Ryan Fitzpatrick and who is that backup from Green Bay? Matt Flynn. Kirk Cousins is probably one of the smartest off the field men in terms of getting his contract that there ever has been in the NFL, next to Fitzpatrick and Flynn.
So looking at Stephon Diggs, I agree with you regarding the being cost controlled, being proven. He's 26 years old this year. He's under contract for at least the next two seasons because the Buffalo Bills have an out in 2022, or it would cost them only $3 million to cut ties with Stephon Diggs. Doubt that that's going to happen. He's an unrestricted free agent in 2024 when he turns 30, so he can cash in one more time. Looking at this though, John, for me, I agree with you saying that we can take a first round pick and go draft a wide receiver and develop him. But the Buffalo Bills need to find out this season if Josh Allen is the guy, because he's heading into his third season where the Buffalo Bills have a certain amount of time where they have to determine whether or not they want to exercise that fifth year option on Josh Allen. And if he goes out this year and tears the cover off or throws the cover off the ball, I guess I'm using the wrong sports cliches here. Then the Buffalo Bills can easily pick up his fifth year option, but they, if they don't believe that he's the guy for the job, either they'll go out and find somebody else, or they'll do what the Bears are doing with Mitch Trubisky, saying, we're going to essentially let you bet on yourself. If you come out and have a bomb ass season,
prove us right.
Exactly. If you have a bomb ass season, for lack of a better explanation, we'll pay you. But if you don't, you're going to be headed to the unemployment line looking for a back quarterback job somewhere. So I think the value Josh Allen brings is evident so far, but he needs to make that next step with Stephon Diggs. And we'll talk about the offense here in a couple minutes.
All right. But before you do that, can I ask you a question? Sure. What do you, as the resident Bills fan, Bills being your number one team, Bills, they're my number two team right now, but you know, the Bills being your number one team, do you believe in Josh Allen? Because I seem to recall over the course of the past two seasons here with Trust the Podcast, mind you, the first season, Del Reed and I kind of split. And last season was pretty much all me. And I was always on the Josh Allen bandwagon. No Bills fan can say that I was not on the Josh Allen bandwagon from the get-go. You, my friend, were not. What do you think? Do you think Josh Allen is in fact the guy? Do you think he's going to take that step, or are you on the fence with him, like let's say Cleveland fans are with Baker Mayfield right now?
I mean, I'm still on the fence, I think, with Josh Allen. He's shown a lot.
Why are you on the fence with him? I don't understand this. I don't understand this. Why are, and not just you, Ryan, but Bills fans in general, like, why are you on the fence with Josh Allen? Okay.
I mentioned I want to give you one reason why.
Go ahead.
And then I'll let you go off, I promise. It's the Mitch Trubisky effect. You see that first season, he gets his feet wet.
I have a quarterback that was drafted three or four spots ahead of Josh Allen in Sam Darnold, and literally all of the Jets fans. You know, granted, we haven't had jack shit to cheer for the last, you know, 10 years since Sanchez brought us to our last AFC championship game. But like the general consensus amongst the Jets fan base is we're going to get behind this guy. We're going to get behind Darnold. We think he's our guy. It's our coach that's crappy. So I honestly think, I mean, for the first 3 years between Baker Mayfield, Josh Allen, I'm not going to include Lamar Jackson in this. Lamar Jackson, obviously everybody whiffed on that one. But between Baker Mayfield, Josh Allen, and Sam Darnold, Josh Allen has had the freaking better career out of the three of them. You know what I mean? Like, if I had Josh Allen on the Jets, I would be thrilled. And I like Sam Darnold.
Look at it right now, and you need to see, I need to see out of Josh Allen make that next step where he can be counted on in those games where the Buffalo Bills defense struggles and Josh Allen needs to make the play. I'm talking things, small things like his decision making, his ability to complete passes downfield, stuff like that.
So
that
basically will help, like under pressure kind of
stuff that will help, stuff that will over time help him become the next level. Right now, I feel like he's middle of the pack in the National Football League when it comes to quarterbacks, understandably so. I mean, he threw for 3,000 yards last season in 16 games. But he threw for 20 touchdowns and 9 interceptions. That's great. Don't get me wrong. And then on the rushing side of things, where was it here? He ran for 510 yards and 9 touchdowns. That's great. So he had 29 combined touchdowns last season. That's fantastic. But when you put Stephon Diggs on one of his ends as one of his wide receivers, you're expecting him to make a step forward. And if Josh Allen comes out and has the same season, now granted, I would take 10-6 in a playoff appearance again. Don't get me wrong. But if Josh Allen comes out and throws for 3,000 yards and 20 touchdowns, you're like, okay, what's the problem here? Is this his ceiling or is there more in the tank? And they've just been kind of babying him along. Because obviously his first season, that's what they did. Last year, they kind of took the reins off a little, but there were still training wheels on for a lot of the season. It felt like as the year went on, it felt like they kind of trusted him more.
Okay.
I want to see the Buffalo Bills, Sean McDermott, Brian Daboll, trust Josh Allen to lead this offense and to lead this team.
Okay.
And see if he can do that. Because if he can't do that, here's the thing. If he can't do that and you just have essentially a glorified game manager who can run the ball really well from under center, then you need to build your team around that guy. But they want to have a dominant defense and a dominant offense because that's, again, if you have both of those, one or the other can pick you up at any certain time.
Okay.
But if it's the defense is struggling and you know Josh Allen's going to be bad if you play him this specific way, that's what I'm saying is make that next step where he becomes top 10 quarterback in the league. And then, I mean, I know I keep kicking the can, but it's like I still see – it's like when you meet a girl and you're like, there's a lot of good things I like about her, but there's these few red flags. And those red flags just never seem to go away. Even though all this great stuff gets greater and greater and greater, those red flags are still there. I just want those red flags to either be confirmed so we know that they're there or go away so we're like, okay, look, it. That was just him developing as a quarterback, as a player in the National Football League. That's what I'm waiting for.
So here's what I see. Here's what I see. I don't think Josh Allen is a top 10 quarterback in the National Football League. I don't think he is. I think he's top 15. I think he's more of the Alex Smith mold than he would be of the Aaron Rodgers mold. And for the sake of Bills fans the Bills fans that tolerate me and like me, I hope I'm wrong there. But I think for what you personally might be looking for, a quarterback like Darnold or Mayfield might have been a better fit in Buffalo than Josh Allen is. But I don't – that said, I think that – I don't think Josh Allen needs to be a top 10 quarterback in order for the Bills to be successful.
Sure.
I think that with the process, if you will, the process – Sean McDermott, the culture, the change that, and McDermott's even acknowledged and said that when he got that extension, and he said, I just like how the whole mindset of coming to Buffalo and, you know, playing against Buffalo and everything about Buffalo has changed because of the overall culture. You may not need a top 10 quarterback. I'm not saying he's going to, he needs to be Trent Dilfer, because he's better than Trent Dilfer, in my opinion. But in that same respect, if he's top 15 and he throws for 3,000 yards and, each season, but the Bills make the playoffs and gradually increase, that's a good thing. That's a very good thing. You know, if he could go Alex Smith, borderline Matt Ryan, I think the Bills would be very, very happy with that and should be very, very happy with that.
Before we move on to the free agency, because I did have the podcast all spelled out, but it's the first time John and I have talked in weeks, months on a podcast, weeks just face-to-face, I guess, over microphones. So things have kind of gotten a little convoluted, which is totally fine because we're still trying to figure out what this season is going to be. But thinking about it, I mean, I think the Buffalo Bills are obviously invested in Sean McDermott. They signed him to a contract extension over the offseason. The defense is good, borderline great. I think the most pressure this season is on Josh Allen to perform. And if he leaves any doubt in anyone's mind, I don't think the Buffalo Bills are going to be afraid to try to replace him. They love him. He's like their little golden retriever, it seems like. But but I mean, it's a situation where it's difficult. It's difficult to win in the National Football League, win championships in the National Football League, I think. And if you have any sort of negativity or sort of negative on your team, it's going to be difficult. Obviously, sorry, I'm trying to read and talk at the same time. I think that they're just not going to be afraid to replace him. I mean, I'm looking down the road, crystal ball type of thing, but it comes down to Josh Allen needs to perform, and Josh Allen needs to just do a little more and be a little more effective with better players around him.
Well, Josh Allen, if you're listening to this podcast, this guy believes in you. So I'm just messing with you, Ryan.
Well, I was going to say the one thing I was reading that got me off topic here, so I stopped thinking about it. The Buffalo Bills announced today they waived fullback Patrick DeMarco with an injury settlement. So it looks like he was going to be out for the season anyway, so they cut him and just paid him off. Okay, anyway, sorry, apologize.
All right. No worries. But you know what? You're absolutely right there. This is indeed make or break year for Josh Allen because the Buffalo Bills proved that they are committed to giving their team the best chance to win. Making the Stephon Diggs move was that statement that was saying, okay, we know we got John Brown last season and he was a speedster and you still overthrew him by 20 yards. Now we've got Stephon Diggs, who is absolutely positively, you know, John Brown is a good receiver, but he's like a two. He's a 1B or a two. Diggs is a number one, bona fide number one. There's no question about that. So that, I believe, puts the pressure on Josh Allen to say, okay, this team went out and did everything I need to succeed. If I can't do it here, then yes, I could absolutely see, with the offensive line being what it is, with Singletary coming out into his own, getting Diggs, you know, having I believe Cole Beasley still on the team. He'd be, you know, him in the slot. John Brown still there.
Yeah, I was going to say, we'll talk about it. I got a little clip down below here about the offense that I do want to chat with you with about. I can't speak words. English is hard, apparently.
English is your second language. It's okay.
Clearly, yeah, and dumbass is my first one. So I just want to run through this quick, John, before I get too off task here, because I know that.
All right. I will say this again, another breaking down the wall method. I am the president of Gear Network. So executive decision. After you run through this, we're going to have to hit a commercial break.
Oh, that's fine.
Commercial breaks are on this podcast, folks. We're so big. We are. I don't want to say we're so big, but we're growing enough. And you, the listeners, for real, me talking to you listeners as the president of Gear Network, you guys, Bills Mafia, that have tuned into this podcast and given it all the love and all the shares and everything, like, thank you so much because of that. Like, we actually have sponsors that pay for advertising here on this podcast now. So in the past two seasons, we just kind of talked right through. This year, we're going to have occasional breaks here and there in the podcast. So bear with us. If you could just do us a solid and just make sure you listen to all of the commercials, regardless, mute it if you have to, you know, but just let it play out. Don't skip it. It does us all a very, very big solid, but that is new this year. I apologize in advance if you don't like commercials. Anyways, Ryan, go ahead.
Running through really quickly, free agency. The Buffalo Bills added cornerback Josh Norman, a one-year reclamation project, low risk, high reward. They add defensive end Mario Addison. Again, we talked about that defensive depth. He's going to be huge. He had 9.5 sacks in 2019. Linebacker A.J. Klein from the New Orleans Saints. He's projected to start at strong side linebacker. We don't know because we haven't heard anything because they've pretty much been treating training camps like they are secret. And guard Brian Winters from the New York Jets, also a depth player who I believe made the roster, if I remember correctly. Also, real quick, before we hit the commercial break, John, the Buffalo Bills re-signed cornerback Tre'Davious White, a four-year, $70 million contract extension announced on September 5th. Pro Football Focus points out, quote, 68 cornerbacks have seen at least 150 passes thrown into their coverage over the past three seasons, and no one's passer rating, not even Stephon Gilmore's passer rating, has been lower than Tre'Davious White's mark of 59.8. Tre'Davious White's 37 forced incompletions are a top 10 mark at that position as well. So good on Buffalo for finally re-signing one of their very young, talented players. He's part of that core defense. He's a leader, both offensive and defensive, just a team as a whole. Tre'Davious White is fantastic. And then I just want to wrap up the second of the three big things because we've already talked about all of it. There was no preseason. We didn't hear anything. We don't know what's going to happen. The Bills so much as went and suspended their own team reporter and radio host Chris Brown for violating these rules. So Sunday's going to roll around. We don't have any idea what we're going to talk about. We don't know what's going to happen. Football's going to happen. But guess what else is going to happen, John?
What's that?
There's going to be more Trust the Podcast right after this quick break.
Oh, I like that. Very well done, Ryan.
And with that, we're back. Trust the Podcast. Ryan Wolfe at Wolfe BLTD. John Cimino at the JC Money Talk and the Buffalo Bills on episode
6. I am JC Money. The JC Money still
suspended. Can I say the JC? Oh, my
God. You sure did. I'm still trying to get that damn thing. Because here's what I want to do. I want to get that damn account unsuspended. So that way I can just move I am JC Money over to that one and get all like 500 of my followers back. Because none of y'all follow me in the new one. You're all assholes for that.
That's coming from the heart right there. Now we're looking ahead. We're looking ahead at 2020, which is our third of the three big things. But as I mentioned during the commercial break, I'm getting tired because I'm an old man. I had to clean my new
house. Get out of here with this old man shit. I'm going to be 40 in December.
I'll be 29 in a couple weeks.
Oh, 29. Get out of here, Ryan. Do you realize when you were still in diapers, you want to know what I was watching and what I was doing?
You were on New Millennium Wrestling on Channel 16 or whatever it was.
When you were in diapers?
I don't know.
You weren't on diapers when I was on New Millennium Wrestling. I was talking about – I was watching Life Without Shame when you were in diapers, okay? Oh, God. for those of you Rochesterians that are watching this that are my age that hear the terms – that hear Life Without Shame, you're all nodding your head and laughing right now, I bet.
I remember my dad used to have a t-shirt of that. I don't know what it is, but we'll have to talk about that.
Google it, Ryan. Google it. So, do it while we're on the podcast. Do it right now. Seriously, Google it. Just go Google Life Without Shame, Rochester, New York. Do it.
I'm looking right now.
Right, I'm going to do it. I'm going to do it as well because this shit better
Reddit. Work. Whatever happened to the Life Without Shame guys? I'm nervous, I guess.
Yeah, again, I bring shtick.
Oh, is this just some dude doing dumb shit?
Yeah, it's it was Ryan. It was a public access show.
Okay.
that
someone would, said that seven, go, 6 years ago. Would, my mom canceled cable because she caught me watching it once.
It was a public access show that was, you know, go to strip clubs, you know.
I mean, it says, if I remember correctly, didn't they do only topless while I was on public access?
Yeah.
At the very end after
Oh yeah. It was great. Back in the day. Lord.
Wow.
Now you get it for free everywhere on your phone. But back then,
the first time I saw Mark McGuire kill himself, I was 12 years old, had bad dreams.
Ladies and gentlemen, what you have experienced right now is something that you could experience once patreon.com/TJCMS podcast is up and running. This type of stuff, like this type of stuff will happen on the regular over there. So
hey,
be on the lookout
hey, by
for
the
that.
Way, by the way, I saw a video on Twitter that's that. Let's see here, who is it? Oh yeah, Donald Trump's press secretary says that Obama and Biden promised a COVID vaccine. Shut the fuck up. Anyways, going over to the Buffalo Bills. Going over to the Buffalo Bills. Looking ahead at 2020. We've talked a lot about 2020 in the 2021 season, I guess, 2020-21. Whatever. The football season coming up in a few days. We've talked a lot about it. So I'm just going to say the third of the three big things, plus our look ahead brought to you by 26 Shirts, which you can check out, 26shirts.com. Facebook.com/26shirts, at 26shirts on Twitter and Instagram. Dell, hello. We'll talk to you soon. The Buffalo Bills play week one, Sunday, September 13th. The New York Jets come to Buffalo or at Bills Stadium. What is this? Like, what are we, five? At Bills Stadium, they take on the Buffalo Bills. Now, John, the one thing I want to point out, with the addition of Stephon Diggs, this team lives and dies in the right arm of Josh Allen, as we've talked about. But the 11 personnel, that is a package you're going to hear a lot about this season. The Buffalo Bills ran this package 69.8% of the time last season. Very nice.
Thank you, Ryan. I was going to interrupt you and say, what number was that again?
But I always just correct myself. You know, that's kind of like when you say,
attaboy.
Crack a joke and then say, that's what she said. To your own joke. That's what I do. I'm so lame. With Stephon Diggs added to the mix, expect to see more of the 11 personnel package in 2020. Per sharpfootballstats.com, when running 11 personnel last season, the Buffalo Bills were 246 for 429 passing, a 15-9 touchdown to interception ratio, and 9.0 yards per attempt. They also had 292 rushing attempts with 7 rushing touchdowns and 5 yards per carry under the 11 personnel package. Now, John, expect to see something like Stephon Diggs on one side, John Brown on the other. I'm presuming Diggs on the left, Brown on the right, Beasley in the slot, Dawson Knox at tight end lined up on the end of the line, and Josh Allen likely in the shotgun with Devin Singletary in his hip pocket or Zach Moss, whoever it may be.
That is a scary and, quite frankly, very dangerous combination.
Very
that
strong
you have there.
Offensive line, too.
Mm-hmm. Again, we're on paper because the game has it could wind up being disastrous, but on paper, oof, that's scary.
Oh yeah, it is, and that's why it's so exciting to get ready for football this season, because we don't know what to expect. Which brings me to this game on Sunday. Who knows what to expect? Because again, we haven't seen the Buffalo Bills on the field aside from whatever the team has tweeted out, because there's been a media lockdown. Only a certain amount of people have been able to watch practice and can't actually report like the plays, the formations. So Sunday is literally going to be the preseason, the regular season, the dress rehearsal, whatever you want. It's all going to be, it may be really wide open, crazy football. It may be the worst game you've ever seen in your lifetime. We don't know. That's the fun part. But John, what we expect is the Buffalo Bills to handle the New York Jets at Bills Stadium.
Yes, it. I mean, again, as the resident Jets fan here, this is going to be a bye week for you guys. There is the Jets have done nothing to indicate to me that they are going to be where the Buffalo Bills are. Hell, even where the where the Miami Dolphins are right now, within the next couple of years, I think they're a head coach away from that. I think they have the talent on the team to make a splash. I don't think they have the right coach for the people that are on that team. And that's why ESPN's Power Football Index has the Bills at a 62.9% chance. I wish it was a 69.2 chance, but 62.9 chance of Buffalo beating the New York Jets. Now, again, it's all on paper. The Jets defense they still have Greg Williams there, and the Jets defense could punch the offense in the mouth. It's highly unlikely, but it's possible. I don't see that happening.
Crazier things have happened.
I don't know. I don't know now that once Tom Brady left and before Cam Newton actually signed with the Patriots, I don't know that the AFC East is the Buffalo Bills to lose anymore. Like I think it's thought pretty it close. Like I want to thought it would, homer,
but I think it's pretty close.
I think it's close. I think prior to the Newton signing, I said openly, very openly, the AFC East is the Bills' division to lose. I don't think that anymore.
I mean, what the hell is Jared Stidham anyways, you know?
Right, exactly. But I again, being everything being on paper right now, it's as good. Our guesses right now at this very moment are as good as our guesses were 2 months ago when we did a season prediction on BLTD. You know what I mean? It's all speculation right now. I don't see the Bills losing this game, and that's the most important part. Let's by how much they will lose, or they'll beat the Jets by, I have no idea.
Give me a prediction. Gun to head.
Oh, a prediction. I'm going to say 24-17 Buffalo.
I was going to say 24-13. I was almost going to say get out of town.
Oh, you're going to say 24. You say 24-13. I mean, that's close. That's within a, you know, that's inside of a touchdown margin. I would say 24. I would give them two touchdowns and a field goal. The Jets.
I just don't know.
I think they're good for that.
I mean, they're going to come out and probably try to showcase Stephon Diggs, especially with Jamal Adams no longer being with the Jets. I certainly think that secondary.
That's a major loss for the Jets.
I mean, I would have to think that the Bills, and even if they come out and someone and they double Stephon Diggs, you still got John Brown, you still got Cole Beasley, Dawson Knox, who they've been talking up through preseason, or whatever you want to call it, training camp, COVID camp, mm-hmm. whatever you want to call it. So we'll see.
COVID camp. I like that.
We'll see what happens. But mm-hmm. either way, John, it feels so good to be back. It's so good to hear your voice and talk on a podcast again, get out some new content. It's been so long.
Yes, absolutely. And I'm going to hold you to the, you better have your Zoom video ready because I'm going to commemorate. And again, here's another spoiler for you. The idea for the TJCMS podcast, the JC Money Show podcast, my standalone podcast. We are within the next week or two. I'd like to commemorate BLTD turning 6.
Hell yeah.
And that I want to do that as a special on the JC Money Show podcast / video cast. I can almost assure you that there will be between me and Perez
shenanigans.
That not only will there be shenanigans on the TJCMS podcast that you all will see, but trickling over to the TJCMS Patreon page, there's probably going to be a little bit more. I feel like, Ryan, we have to do that on a weekend day.
Oh, sure.
Where I don't have the kids.
I think I would agree with you on that one.
Okay, I'm cool. Very good. So look forward to BLTD's 6th anniversary sort of being commemorated in a formerly known as Get Ready America / TJCMS way.
Absolutely.
Basically, if you would turn into that podcast as we commemorate BLTD, if you're looking for sports, you're probably not going to get a lick of it in that podcast. I'm just warning you all right now.
You talk about a couple of sports. I'm sure you can come up with something. But John is at I am.
Well, I mean, I'll make Magic Johnson jokes probably, but that's about it.
You always do. It's okay.
I always do. He's a very positive person.
Oh, Jesus Christ, here we go. John is at IMJCMoney. I am at WolfBLTD. John, we are Trust the Podcast.
You are not.
We will catch you sometime next week to wrap up week one of the Bills 2020 NFL season. As always, thanks for tuning in. Thanks for coming back. Thanks for sticking around. And let's go, Bills.
And also, put the masks over your freaking noses, people.
Well, Jesus. No one's gonna be at the stadium this weekend anyway, so it's okay.
Well, they're going to Wegmans, aren't they? They go to Wegmans, they go to Tops, they're going
allegedly.
Whatever. Okay, go ahead, wrap it up, Ryan.
Go Bills.
The preceding presentation has been brought to you by the Gear Network.